Okay, so my name is Natalia Ortiz de Zarate. I work at UNE, the standardization body in Spain, and I'm representing ISO in this case, and I'm going to talk about ISO 24010 on verbal charters. I would like to thank the organizers for letting me explain a little bit more about ISO standards. Some of you might have been on Frank's presentation. It's a little bit more detailed than what Frank has presented before. So, let's go this way. So I'm going to speak about what is a standard and what's its purpose. What is ISO, the International Standardization Organization? What is the Technical Committee 228, who is responsible of this ISO standard on verbal charters? We are going to analyze a little bit the contents of this ISO standard, and we are going to have a quick overview on other related standards or current projects. And finally, we are going to explain the benefits of implementing this standard. So what's a standard and what's its purpose? Let me just tell you a little story that explains a little bit more clearly what's a standard. We are in at the beginning of the 20th century in the States, you know, the cities, were growing with more people and people living there. And in 9004, there was a fire broken into a building, into a textile company in Baltimore. And the fire broke out very, very dangerously and stepped from one building to another. When they were like 80 buildings covered by the fire, they called the reinforcement to other nearby cities, such as New York, Philadelphia, and they came very quickly to help to fight the fire. But they had a problem. The hoses didn't fit with the hydrants, you know, the equipment in the street that is connected to the water network. So they had to look how more buildings until 2,500 buildings burned in Baltimore, because simply they didn't have the hoses the same diameter as the fire as the water hydrants in Baltimore, because they were from another city. So this is a clear example of what is, for example, a non-standardized product that things do not fit together. After this fire, they analyzed in the States, in the whole United States, all the fire hoses and the systems used by all the cities in the States. They find out that there were more than 600 different systems in the whole United States. 1 year later, they came into agreement and they had one standard for the whole United States of America. So that's a clear example of the purpose of a standard, is make things work better. But there are still examples of a world without standards. I guess you are all traveling around the world and have faced this problem, let's say a problem, because if you have forgotten your adapter, sometimes you will not be able to plug your mobile, your computer, and to recharge batteries. That's an example of a world without standards, where if you go to Japan and then you go to the States or to Spain or wherever you want to, the plug will not fit into the socket. And that's another example of a world with standards. I've just selected four examples that I think all of you have right now, or at least you know. The paper, the dimensions of the paper. How do we do so that a sheet of paper can fit into a photocopy, into a printer? Why they do fit here and in Croatia and in UK and in the States? Because they share a common language, common dimensions. And these were set out in a German standard called DIN A4, for example, for A4. And this is made with a metric system that A4 is half of A3, and A3 is half of A2, and so on. This is an example that we all know, sheets of paper. And this is a pen, big pen. You know that in the cap, you have a little hole in the cap. And what's that hole? Is there because of a standard to avoid choking. And this was because of there were some accidents, and then in a standard it was fixed that all of them, all of the caps should have a little hole. Another example, the credit cards. Why, if you go to Japan or to Singapore and to Australia and wherever you go to a cash machine, your credit card fits in the ATM? Why is that? Because they all share the same dimensions, and they all share the same, let's say, electronic system that recognizes that this is a credit card. And the last one, I think we all have on us clothes. These graphical symbols, these are also standardized. So we all know if we want to go to the, if we have to go to the dry cleaners, or we can use the washing machine at home, and the temperature, and the temperature of the ironing, and so on. So these are examples of a world with standards. So standards are really everywhere. They are not only in specific 9001 or the bareboat charters. If you realize, standards are really everywhere and make things work better. So, all in all, a standard is a technical specification, is a document, is a voluntary nature. I mean, it's different than legislation, is voluntary, is not compulsory, unless the legislator decides that this voluntary standard comes into, let's say, a compulsory reference. When is that? When the legislator says, okay, I need to legislate about one thing, and I don't know a clue about what, you know, what's in there, what to do, but I have a standard made from the industry about the best way of doing things. So if in my legislation I said, okay, you have to follow ISO, blah, 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 then this ISO standard, which is voluntary in nature, becomes compulsory. But this only happens quite a few times. In Spain, for example, which is my example, the country I represent, there's about 12% of standards that are mentioned cited in legislation. But the other, the rest of the standards are just voluntary. This is a flexible document as well. An ISO standard can standardize funerary services, bareboat services, postal services, anything, because it's flexible. We adapt the contents to the needs of the market. It's made by consensus. In fact, this is an agreement by all the parties involved in the value chain. I mean, it's not a question of just voting, it's a question of discussing, of reaching an agreement, of getting consensus around the table by all the experts. It's made in an open and transparent process. It's true that ISO has his procedures, and you have to go from a ballot to a circulation of the documents, receive more comments, and then you discuss those comments, and then again a new ballot. But this, ensures that the process is transparent, and that you can have access to the results, and that there is a public inquiry at some point in the development of the ISO standards where anyone can comment, and is open because anyone can participate as well. And it's accessible to the public. It's different from a specification from a company or from an association, which is only for this association or only for this company. It's accessible to the public because you can go to the ISO webpage and buy this standard. Of course, standards are sold. This doesn't mean they are not accessible. They are accessible. But we have to pay a price. They are recognized, these documents are recognized by an international organization, such as ISO in this case. And they are, above all, they are a guide for internal improvement. I mean, they help you to do things better. This is the aim of the ISO standards. So a standard contains requirements that in the standard, if you go to any standard, you will find some shells. This means requirement in the ISO language. And you will find some recommendations that are where we use a should recommendations. So requirements are compulsory within the nature of voluntary standards, of course. And recommendations are things that, you know, maybe we didn't get the consensus around the table to put a shall, and we had to put a should, which is a recommendation. So international standards give specification for products, service, and systems to ensure quality, safety, and efficiency. This is the key, and they, of course, facilitate international trade. Let me just speak a little bit about ISO, the International Organization for Standardization. ISO comes from the Greek word isos, meaning equal. Why is that? Because they thought that, you know, if you use the acronym, it will be different in every country. While if you use ISO everywhere, it will be the same. It means equal because all the countries have the same voice. I mean, it doesn't matter whether, you know, United States, Croatia, Spain, or whatever country, they all have one vote in the ISO system, one country, one vote. Independently of the size, economical power, or the importance of the country, they all have one vote. Is an independent non-governmental international organization. It has 164 countries involved, and these countries are represented by the national standards bodies. ISO doesn't provide certification or conformity assessment. ISO only publish and ensures that the standards are made following certain procedures, and they sell the standards, but they don't certify. They don't say, you comply with these standards, I'll give you my ISO logo. This is not made by ISO. This is made by certification bodies. So through its members, it brings together experts, because it's not ISO in Geneva who write the standards. It's you, the experts of a topic, who sit around the table in different committees and create the ISO standards. So brings together experts to share knowledge and develop voluntary consensus-based market-relevant international standards that support innovation and provide solutions to global changes. And in fact, ISO was born with the idea of answering this question, what's the best way of doing things? Well, this is a photograph about the first meeting of ISO in 1946 and 1947. A few women, by the way. but before that, I mean, this was just after the Second World War. We had to rebuild the world, and we needed standards for that. And so that this is the first meeting in London, and then the office was settled in Geneva. But before that, we had kind of different standards, so-called standards in the past, before 1946. We have coins, we have language, we had weight to trade. These are also kind of standards, because they fix, they identify, they explain things. Then in the Industrial Revolution, we had in the 19th century, we had the metric system in place, and we had also the railway transport. And one way of making transport work better was to fix the distance between the rails. How? With a standard, so-called standard, not an ISO standard by that time. Also, how can we transport all these freight containers without having problems? Because they all share the same dimensions, and they can be transported on a ship, or they can be transported on a lorry, because they have specific measures that make that this is possible. And there was an ISO standard in the 60s, 1960s, about freight containers that help transport. In the 70s, we had the first, let's say, standards for air quality and water quality. So we moved from a product, tangible product, to different things, air, environment. And in the 90s, in the 80s, the first quality management system, 9001. So we have evolved from product control with weapons mainly, because the world wars were boosting standardization in this case, to different kind of standards more related to services. So ISO figures, I told you 164 countries, more than 700 organizations in liaisons. This is organizations that do not represent a specific country, but they represent an industry at the international level. And they are also entailed to participate. We have in ISO 3,500 technical bodies, meaning committees, working groups, subcommittees that are discussing every day. We have 22,000 standards published in ISO. I told you there is a standard for nearly everything. And more or less, we have 26 technical meetings in progress on average each working day of the year somewhere in the world. This is the work of ISO. And nowadays, it has more than 4,000 projects. So the work continues. And UNE, the company I'm representing now, is a Spanish member of ISO. ISO has only one member in each country. And UNE is a Spanish association for standardization and is the member of ISO, is ISO in Spain, let's say. And the thing that I am here is because I'm the technical committee manager of ISO Technical Committee on Tourism and Related Services, which is the responsible body of this bareboat charter. So what is this committee about? This committee was created in 2005. The leadership is UNE, Spain, and INORPI, Tunisia. We are sharing a twinning arrangement, and the scope is the standardization of the terminology and specifications of the service offered by tourism service providers, including related activities, touristic destinations, and the requirements and facilities and equipment used by them to provide tourism buyers, providers, and consumers with criteria for making informed decisions. So, the key facts. We have more than 100 countries participating or involved in this ISO technical committee, plus 23 organizations in liaisons. We have 9 active working groups, 31 standards published, and among them the bareboat standard. We have 12 projects nowadays working, and we won the ACER Award in 2017. It's kind of the Oscar of the standardization, which is given every year to a special committee that, you know. And as a result, we have a video here, but maybe you will receive the presentation, or maybe we can just try to put it for a second. It's very short. I think it's because it's in presentation mode. No, but it's only here. Well, it doesn't matter. Just you will have, I guess, the presentation, so you will be able to understand. It's a very short video, a presentation about what we do in ISO TC228. Doesn't matter. So, how to participate in standards? I told you before that ISO is open to anyone to participate. We need experts. We need you to write the standards you want to use later. So to participate in standards, this is a kind of a map of the countries that are nowadays participating in ISO TC228, which is the Committee on Tourism. The blue ones are the ones participating more actively, and the orange ones are the observers, one that do receive the information, do have the right to comment and attend meetings, but are kind of not participating in the writing, in the drafting of the documents. So the best way to participate is to contact your National Standardization Institute. Here in Croatia is Croatian Standardization Institute. I put the website. There is one, as I told you, in every country. This is the one for Croatia. But if you go to ISO, you will find all the members in every country. Identify the working group or the committee of your interest and be appointed an expert by this National Standardization Institute. And then you are able to participate in ISO meetings, to receive the information, to attend meetings, to contribute and to influence in what is the very end of the document. So this is our structure in ISO TC 228. We are touching different fields from diving to health tourism, adventure tourism, yacht harbors, led by different countries with different projects and standards already published. We are working also in sustainable tourism, in accessible tourism, in accommodation standards, and in restaurants. These are the 9 working groups, plus the working group 11 bareboat charters, led by United Kingdom, Stuart Carruthers, with one standard and one project going on. So let's talk a little bit more about the bareboat charter standard. So the title, well, it was published at the very end of 2017, and but a standard is nothing if it's just kept on the shelf. We need you, the experts, the industry, the market, to use them, because otherwise they are useless. We have worked for anything, for nothing. So that's why we are, you know, promoting the use of standard, not just this standard, but the other standards made by this Committee on Tourism, because we believe that the first thing is that you know that it exists, you know a little bit more about the contents, and you will have the choice to decide if you want to implement it or not, but at least you will have the information. So it was promoted by the Royal Yachting Association, also the European Boating Association, representing the consumers. And this is also very important because it has a bottom-up approach. I mean, is the problem that generates the needs for a standard. What is the standard about? It's an international standard on bareboat charters. The project started in 2015, and yes, 2 years to draft the standard. This is the usual timing in ISO to produce a document with the consensus from the industry and from the countries involved, and where it was produced in ISO TC Technical Committee Tourism and Related Services and in this working group. But the more important is why. Why this standard was produced? Because there was an increasing offer of bareboat charters, competitive prices, yes, easy access through internet and direct booking, different service quality, difficulty for the client to measure, to compare, and to choose the best options, because the things that were offered are not the same. They are difficult to be compared. Also because of the eruption of inadequate practices which provide bad reputation to the sector and undermine customer trust, and some clients and the sector partially unsatisfied. This motivated the creation of this bareboat charter standard. So the proposal, you know that there is an ISO directive that covers recreational craft in terms of construction, but this does not cover the service. So there was a need to create a series of common guidelines that agreed by the industry to regulate voluntarily the provision of such services. And this will create a common foundation at international level that help to clarify the market, which is the most important thing, and result in the end in the satisfaction of both the supplier and the customer. So the scope of this standard, all the standards have a table of contents, then they have an introduction. But the most important part is the scope, because the scope tells you is this standard for me? To whom it is addressed? And what is this standard about? So if you can read the paragraph, you will know, is this standard for me? Yes, no. So you don't need to read the whole standard to say it's applicable to me. Yeah, it applies to me. So sets out the minimum service level and equipment requirements for bareboat charters. It is applicable to any individual or organization that offers this service, and it covers the safety of the bareboat and its occupants, but is not not the associated sport water-based recreational activities. It excludes boats that are provided with a skipper or crew and bareboats that do not have living accommodation. And it does not establish the construction requirements for bareboats and equipment provided, because this is set in other standards. So it's just the service and the equipment, but not technical requirements about the equipment. But to say if we need two life-saving or three, I mean, it depends on this standard. We have some terms and definitions in all the standard. We have the title, we have the table of contents, we have the introduction, we have the scope. But then, as we want to, let's say, to talk in a common language, we need to agree on the terms we are going to use in the standard. So I've just excerpted three terms that I think that are key: bareboat, charter provider, and charter agreement. We have the bareboat, which is the boat with living accommodation charter without skipper or crew provided by the charter provider. We have the charter provider, which is the individual or the organization responsible for offering a bareboat for charter. And we have the charter agreement, which is the contract between the charterer and the charter provider. Of course, we have the charterer, which is the one that hires the bareboat. And we have general aspects as well: responsibility, advertisement, and information. Responsibility: who is responsible for chartering the charter provider? And if there are other parties involved, it should inform the charterer about those parties and their responsibilities as well. The advertisement should be accurate and clear and respond to the offer. Information: it has to be detailed. These are requirements, are general requirements in this bareboat standard. Then we have the service provision. We have in advance of the bareboat charter, we have to comply with all these things. We have to have a charter agreement. This is the basic thing. We have to explain the bareboat details. We have to mention in this charter agreement the dates and of charter and duration, the location for handover, the charter fee, how is it going to be paid, in which currency, by which methods. The evidence of competence: the charter provider shall ask the charterer to have competence for hiring this bareboat. The consumables, the services and options, everything needs to be clear. The security deposit, operating restrictions, if any, assistance during the charter. There need to have an emergency protocol saying how it will assist the charterer in the event of an emergency. Insurance, the crew list, data protection, and legal requirements. Of course, you have to take into account legislation when providing your services, and you have to identify which is the legislation that applies to you before entering in this ICE award, of course. In the service provision, we have to comply with the requirements for handover. We have to have a procedure for the welcome the charterer. We have to set the requirements for the handover and for the handback. And we, of course, have to have a continuous improvement. We have to have a mechanism to receive the feedback from the charterer and to improve the work. Concerning the equipment, we have navigation equipment, communication equipment, in case we need to contact with the port authorities or with other vessels, the anchor mooring equipment, passerelle, torch and searchlight with enough batteries and spare batteries and bulbs, first aid kit that should be marked, sound signaling devices, emergency reboarding from water, man overboard prevention. So this is, of course, more detail in the standard. I'm just having a quick overview of the type of things you will find in the standard about the equipment. A deck knife, carbon monoxide detector. This is only a recommendation. It's not a requirement for the carbon monoxide detector. LPG detector, life-saving appliances, hose pipe, portable containers, shore power cable. I mean, I'm not going to develop each one of those because for this you need to go to the ISO standard and read carefully all the requirements for each of these. But, I mean, they are not things that we are not used to do. On the contrary, this is part of the equipment you manage in your bareboat. And then you have to go have a manual. I mean, I told you that there are the terms and definitions, some general aspects about responsibility, information, and so on. And then there is the service provision, the equipment, and the manual. These are the three big chapters in the ISO standard. And the manual, what's the manual? The manual is the document that contains all the instructions about the equipment. So it should contain the name, the type of vessel, the tank's capacity, the dimensions of the bareboat, the maximum number of persons, the layout, engine information about, for example, fuel consumption, information related to the risk of flooding and stability, bilge pumps, the location, operating instructions, stability and buoyancy, escape routes, about doors and things like that. Information related to the risk of fire or explosion, electrical systems, handling characteristics, whether it is a motor boat or a sailing boat, information and recommendations for a proper operation, and other information such as, I don't know, weather forecasts, why not? So all this should be contained in the bareboat manual that should be handed to the charterer. A hard copy, and this is compulsory. And also, I wanted to. I mean, you can go more in detail on the standard, but I don't want to bore you with the details. I just wanted to mention other related projects and standards. The same working group that is led by UK is developing a second standard that is now under development, so it's open to your comments, open to your participation if you wish. It's a document that's supplementary charter services and experiences. The previous one we have been talking about is about a boat with living accommodation but no skipper. And this one is a supplementary charter services and experiences by a charter provider. It is applicable also to any individual or organization offering such services, for example, if I need a skipper, if I need a chef, if I need a parking space or to hire a car, or if I need different things to make the whole holiday complete, not just the bareboat. And this standard is about this this whole experience, not just the renting of the bareboat. And this document excludes bareboats that do not have living accommodation and those that are only hired as accommodation, but they don't sail. And also we have some standards related to yacht harbors that are related somehow to the bareboat as well. I remember, Frank, in your presentation, you talk about rating, about stars in hotels. And this is an example of this, because we have a standard divided in three parts. It's yacht harbors, and the first part is minimum requirements for basic service level harbors. Second is intermediate service level harbors, and part three is for high service level harbors. So if you are a basic harbor, then go for the part one. If you feel that you have more services and equipment to offer to your tourists, go for part two, or you can go for part three. So you have different levels that can be adapted to your needs. And they are developing also a standard on yacht harbors, essential requirements for luxury harbors. So the benefits for implementing this standard. For the client, of course, he will receive a better services, and it will be these services adapted to this to his expectations. No bad surprise, no missing points. So if you receive the information, if you comply with the standard, you will get what you are paying for. He will have more information, detailed information about what he is expecting to receive, more safety and protection, and more confidence, and at the end, more satisfaction. So the ISO standard is a way, is a method to differentiate those who provide quality and reliable services in this case. For the service provider, share good practices, because in fact the standard has been made by experts just as you that have been around the table sharing their best practice they do, and the standard is the result of this. Banish illegal or illegal entities, develop professionalism by enhancing working processes and procedures, generate trust among the clients, provides acceptance in the market, and not only acceptance, but it provides a distinction in terms of quality, safety, and sustainability, improve the business and help expand the market internationally, because as you mentioned before, if in Australia something is renting a bare boat and they follow the ISO standard, at least I know that we speak a common language, that they understand what I understand. So help you to expand your market at international level, and help to implement also the sustainable development goals, because it can help you to comply with especially goal 14, life below water, because there are also some environmental recommendations. Differentiate your charter service from those of your competitors. So the key ideas of this presentation are: ISO 24010 is a voluntary standard for bareboat charters made from and for the bareboat charter industry. So it's not ISO or myself, or, you know, it's people like you who have drafted this standard, and people like you who have voted to have this standard, that anyone can participate in standards. For example, in the project that is ongoing right now, you can go to your national standardization body if you want, not just to receive the result at the end of the discussion, but to participate in such discussion. You can influence the result by participating and sending your comments to the document, improving the comment, improving the standard before it's published, not just when you receive it and you say, oh, but this doesn't fit really to what we are doing. Oh, you had the opportunity. It sets out the minimum service and level equipment requirements for bare boats offered for charter or inland, coastal, or offshore waters. It covers service aspects such as duration, location, assistance, details of the boat, handover, handback procedures, but also specifics related to the equipment and the contents of the bare boat manual. It can be implemented by any organization or individual providing such services. And it can be used as an internal guide, or you can be certified by an independent third party. Because ISO, as I mentioned in the beginning of the presentation, do not certify itself. This is ISO puts the standard in the market, and then in the market there are certification bodies, or there are consultancies that help you to implement, because we mentioned in the previous conference, it's not easy to take these 15 pages, of course it's not long, but 15 pages technical standard, and okay, you can read it, but then you have to implement it in your business. And it's sometimes it can, I mean, it's not your, let's say, your core business to implement this standard. You are, you know, with other objectives, problems, and things. So sometimes you might need a little bit of help to implement the standards. And then once you are ready, you can go to an independent third party and ask for a certification. So great things happen when the world agrees. This is the motto of ISO, of the International Standards Organization. So it has been a pleasure to share with you my views on ISO, and I hope you at least have understood the purpose of ISO standards. I don't know if you have any questions. Yes?
In what way does your standard conflict or agree with UK coding?
With? Sorry.
UK coding standard.
I mean, there are, of course, a lot of standards in the market, but ISO standards...
Yes, but the UK coding standard is a legal requirement. So if your standard doesn't agree...
Yeah, legal comes first, always. Of course, it's very difficult with more than 100 countries to put exactly what is needed by each country. That's why, I mean, we can have national standards, but when we come to the international table, we have to make some, you know, balance and try to adapt the contents to all. So... Yeah, well, not really, because if it conflicts with your legislation, you skip that part. I mean, you can say, I can't comply with this specific requirement because my legislation says blah, blah, blah. And you can be certified against the ISO standard, even if there are two, three parts that, you know, it's difficult or impossible because your legislation sets a different thing. While I don't think so, because the leader of the project has been a UK a UK person, a UK expert, so I don't think it will collide with your specific UK legislation, but it might collide with other legislations. In any case, the ISO standard doesn't set that the payment, for example, has to be cash. It just says that you have to fix the way of payment. And then you are free to decide which way and to put it in the charter agreement. I mean, it doesn't say exactly what you have to put in the charter agreement or what you have to do or what you have to have. It just says what you need to include in your services, more information, more transparent. I mean, it doesn't say exactly about how many things you have to do, for example, concerning the equipment. It says that you have to fix what is needed according to the service you are providing and the boat you are offering. Yes?
The middle between the charter provider and the clients, because agencies could affect also the quality of the service, marketing, and all these things.
Yeah.
Or do you plan to include agencies?
Yeah, in this standard, in this version, I'm afraid they are not really included in the standard. We can't find any requirement related to agencies. It's just about the charter provider. But in the standard we are developing now about the whole experience, I think they probably are integrated in this standard because there are more services involved. So probably, I mean, it's still under development. So, I mean, the next meeting is in June next year. You know, things go slowly. But in any case, this can be an idea for a future revision. As you may know, ISO standards are not static. I mean, I have a published standard in the 1968, and that's the standard. No, ISO revises all the standards every 5 years. So every 5 years, ISO knock at the door of the countries and says, okay, is this standard still valid? Do you have comments on this standard? Shall we revise it, amend it, withdraw it? So every 5 years there is this question, and sometimes it's the moment, the industry is mature, the market, to revise a standard and maybe include other parties involved in this market. But one thing should be very clear is usually for in a standard, the user of the standard has to be very clear. So which requirements apply to the charter provider directly and which ones apply to, in this case, hypothetically, an agency, if you want to put all together in the same standard. Otherwise, you can just maybe propose a different standard only for agencies, which is a possibility as well.
Okay, thank you.
Any other question? Okay, so thank you very much for listening to this presentation. And if you have more questions, or I'll be around, or otherwise you can write to me at, well, I forgot to put my email address, but I will include it now and before they circulate the presentation. Okay, thank you very much.